news. Now it is a fabulous Wednesday here in the Phoenix area. We're actually going to be getting kind of warm, like mid 80s, but tomorrow is when the heat really kicks in for us. We're expecting 90 degrees. So we're certainly keeping an eye on the weather, not just here in Phoenix, but across the country. Pilar Arias here with Ron Hoon. Ron, thanks for being with us.
Don't fear the 90s, and I'll tell you why. Because the 110s are coming.
They're coming.
You know, so we don't, you know, you can't just kind of wimp out here in summertime. You just embrace it, you work your way through it, and it just never fails. We always seem to have one or two or three of those days where we're in the 115 plus range, which is when you want to give up. You know, 108s, 105s, 108s, we have those all summer long. But anyway, there'll be a day, believe it or not, if you're just watching us from a different part of the world, which I know we have plenty of people who do, that you'll be begging for the 90s.
Ron, were you here on the hottest day on record
in
Phoenix? I was too. Was it 124? What was it?
It was 122.
Ooh, I was here.
And you were just a little two-year-old? Is that what
no.
you just said? Oh,
I was
2-T-O-O. Oh, that's good. What I remember about it, do you have a memory of it?
Kind of.
Okay.
Slightly.
What I remember was going out to lunch that day. I think it was a Sizzler. Now, back in the good old days in the 90s, we used to have a lot more Sizzlers than we do now. I don't know.
They're coming back, though.
Are they? Seriously, are they good?
They are.
So I remember walking across the parking lot and just, literally, my nostrils burned on that day as just walking across the parking lot, because not only do you have the heat, the radiant heat from the sun, but as it's reflecting off of hot surfaces, it would make it even worse. And it was pretty incredible. But I will just say this. Since then, we've had lots of 118. I shouldn't say a lot. We've had a handful of 117, 118, 119, 120.
But we haven't seen that 122 again. So that
correct.
Was it.
And maybe we never will. But truly, once you get above about 115, it's just all so ridiculous. You don't even sweat it anymore. Compare that to the cold, the bitter cold, the blowing winds, and the snow that is just working its way up and down the East Coast.
Yes, we'll show pictures of that here any moment. But I wanted to start the show because, you know, Extra, you know our name.
Yep.
It's right after Arizona Morning, so want to show people stuff that they don't get to see during the morning show.
Yeah, exactly.
So this, what I'm going to air right now, is a quick interview with a neighbor of the Austin bombing suspect.
Super quick.
It was the biggest news that broke overnight. Police say that he blew himself up as they were trying to approach him outside of a hotel, right?
Yes and no. They were monitoring his activities in a motel in a suburb of Austin called Round Rock. And I'm not sure if they were going to make their move into the hotel room, but the SWAT team was getting all ready. Mm-hmm. Next thing you know, the guy comes out, gets in his car and drives away and actually pulls over into a ditch. And I'll just encourage everybody to stay with us because later this morning, Pilar has the full news conference that actually goes into pretty great detail in terms of how they tracked this guy down and what those last few minutes were like.
Yeah, so let's listen in here really quickly.
No, all I can tell you is that we're praying for the family, and I can't imagine what they're going through. No.
Very brief there, so quick that it actually repeated on us there, but he just said, all I can tell you is I'm thinking and praying for the family. Not much information about the bomber.
Correct. We are, you know, starting to get little glimpses of his life, and apparently has no military background. Remember, that was one of the very earliest questions. Hey, with these basically IEDs, these improvised explosive devices, do you think, they were asking the police chief, doesn't appear that he has any type of military background. The report is that he was trying to take some time off, quote unquote, before deciding what to do with his life, and obviously he made the wrong decision.
This investigation, long from over, this is one of the scenes that police were at this morning, trying to figure out more about who this young man, we're calling him young, he's 24 years old, who this man was right. and why he wanted to do this. Because now that we have a face, you know, his identity has been released.
Correct.
He is Mark Anthony Condit, mm-hmm. who they're calling the serial bomber. Now that we know who, it's kind of the why that we're all trying to put together here. So
yep.
they're visiting neighbors, they're trying to figure out where he lived, who he lived with, and exactly what happened here. But there is surveillance footage from some stores that he dropped off some of the packages at. So, and it looked like he was in disguise. So it's a story that we'll continue monitoring for sure. All right, Ron, we were talking about weather. I'm going to show this picture because it's one of my favorites. We actually have two different places we can take people to live here. Everybody ready?
Yep.
All right, so this is the White House.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of the nor'easter hitting there?
Isn't that a great shot?
It's beautiful, right?
I was just laughing because this time last year, give or take 2 or 3 days, I was actually in Washington, D.C., and we were starting a trip where we were, my wife and I, we were going to go travel through the South, which is such a beautiful part of the country, and got right into Virginia. And, you know, you had a few days where you had some rain. One day we were in Alabama and lived through a tornado warning. But Washington, D.C. was beautiful in the spring,
aww.
Early start of spring, because you know what should be happening right now? Instead of snow, as we get into late March,
mm-hmm.
what should be happening is it should be sunny and the cherry blossoms should be coming
exactly.
out.
Exactly. Less than a week, I've heard they're supposed to bloom, the cherry blossoms. And this is Pittsburgh. So you can see the East Coast there. It looks like a white Christmas sort of scene versus spring.
Yeah, it really does. And this, honest to goodness, four nor'easters in a row, I sort of half jokingly said, on our Fox 10 TV show, just do not bring up global warming to anybody on the East Coast, at least
right.
for a few days, because it feels like the winter that's never going to end.
I know.
These folks. Cold, bitter winds, power outages. And you know what comes after big snows? It won't be long before you get the warm up, and then we'll probably be having stories about flooding. It's just been really a very rough couple of months for folks on the Eastern Seaboard.
Yes. All right. Well, President Trump continuing to make comments about Mueller.
Mm-hmm.
Continuing to see if any more White House staff shakeups are going to happen there. Mm-hmm. A bunch of other things. But a little bit of silver lining, a little bit of good news from today, Ron. It
yes.
seems like there's going to be a budget deal.
Yeah, how about that? $1.3 trillion. Try to just wrap your mind around the kind of money we're talking about here. $1.3 trillion, and it looks like they have a deal, and it looks like it'll take the whole idea of a shutdown off the table for many months to come. I think a lot of people looked at them and thought, well, you bozos, sorry, I shouldn't use a word like that, but you bozos, how can you not? How are you lurching from crisis to crisis? Why can you not get more of a permanent, longer-term deal put together?
Mm-hmm.
Well, so this one has it. Thing is, it's such a massive amount of spending. I guess maybe that's the only way you can get both sides to approve it because there's just so much in there. My understanding is that it includes an $80 billion increase for the military, which gives the president and Republican hawks, I guess you could say, up in the Senate, a big victory to bring the military budget to $700 billion. But at the same time, one of the questions was going to be, what about the border wall?
Right.
So our understanding is that the president wanted $1.6 billion for 74 miles of wall, but instead, oh, also another $1 billion for technology. Instead, there's going to be the $1 billion for technology and $641 million. Sorry, I'm tossing out a lot of numbers here. $641 million for border fencing, but not a wall. So.
Prototypes, too, were mentioned, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe they get a few more prototypes. They already have eight. I mean, I don't know how many they need, but.
But supposedly none of the money in the budget deal go towards new prototypes, so that's kind of the
okay. Well, see, so I mean, the prototype, that's interesting, but I guess the big headline is there's still no money for the wall.
Mm-hmm.
The president wanted to get a deal done. There was a judge that came out on the 5th of March or just before the 5th of March and said, you know, we're going to slow roll this whole thing, and so the deadline that had been put in place was removed. And in Washington, they don't seem to be able to really get a lot accomplished unless their backs are right up against the wall with a major deadline. So since there isn't, right now it doesn't look like there's any kind of long-term DACA deal in here or any wall funding.
Right. So no snow day for Congress. They are probably the only ones working in Washington right now, surprisingly. Mm-hmm. Having two important hearings, one of them on the opioid crisis and the Senate Intelligence Committee hearing. Mm-hmm. I believe that may have already wrapped up. But yeah, so we'll take everybody live now to the opioid hearing. Take a listen to that really quickly here. And Ron, thanks for joining us. As always, appreciate it.
Okay, let's listen into this. This is really a big topic.
Hearing.